We're supposed to be, inshallah, dealing with a topic. It's directed to the sisters, but it also includes the brothers as well. It deals with trials that the Muslim sisters face in the society. That, in addition to some of the questions that were posed by the sisters that were given prior to this sit-down here, or this discussion. We have a trend now where women go out looking the way that... it's just disgraceful. Ladies that are clothed but naked. It is so bad in this day and time that in earlier days, even amongst Kafirs, disbelievers, if you went out in a dress that was up by your knees, it was disgraceful. Now you have Muslim women wearing what is called spandex, man, and going in public. Going in public. They got a short shirt on and it's disgraceful. And the khimar on the head. Almost as if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not reveal the dress code. الرجل رعي على أهل بيته ومسؤول عن رعيته. The man is in charge of everybody in his household. And he shall be questioned by Allah about the things that happened there. You cannot be that weak that you allow it to happen and keep your mouth closed. Men are supposed to be men. You have someone like that, you don't accommodate it by keeping your mouth closed. One of the things that we have, you know, we're facing enough problems outside of the home. Sisters are facing difficulties outside. If they dress it right, people see those Muslims, those terrorists, they're such and such. Okay? But what are you going to do? Take it off? One of the questions that we have, you know, I don't know what brother's doing looking at pornography. That's not awful. A married man looking at pornography? Okay? Now, look, we have some prophetic solution, medication for families. Okay? One of the things the Prophet ﷺ mentioned about the wife, he says, "Khayrun nisa," the best of women, are the ones when you command them, they obey, and when you look at them, they please you. And they do not go against you concerning themselves and their wealth. That's an encouragement for the sisters, for you to adorn yourself for your husband in the home. Put the earrings on. And if he likes to see that lip gloss, then be flowing. If he likes a certain hairdo, then, you know, do it for him. But one of the things that we have in the regulations here, the Prophet ﷺ, where he pointed out the qualities of a good sister, when he says, look, tazawwaju al-wadud al-wadud, he said, marry sisters that are affectionate. You know, someone who ain't going to be toe-to-toe with you when you get upset. Someone who's going to be grown up enough to know how to diffuse a situation and not aggravate it. Okay? The thing is, you know, the Prophet ﷺ pointed out these qualities to show the brothers and the sisters what they can do to neutralize and to make the whole thing better. Okay? So one of the things that you can do to begin to have your husband look at you, do the things that you know he enjoys for you to do. You know, it's not expected for you to look like that every day, but my goodness, 2-3 months come and your hair ain't combed. Huh? And the last time he saw you in that stuff that he likes was on the wedding night? Right? You know he likes to see something, then put it on. And I guarantee you won't be hanging out with your brother so much. But here, we've had brothers come, man, look, sister got me on the couch. I'll be ashamed to even tell and whisper that to myself in the bathroom. The Prophet said, look, if a man calls his wife to be intimate and she refuses, the angels curse her until the morning dies. And the one who is above the sky remains angry with her until he is pleased. So it's unheard of for a person, a Muslim sister, who has some understanding of this deen. And she's having problems in the household. These are ways that you try to clear things up. How many times have we heard people saying, that ain't fair, how come we all get to do that and we can't do it? No. How come men get to do this and women can't do it? Why I got to answer to you? That's an attitude of jahiliyyah, not Islam. When Allah describes righteous sisters, they are obedient constantly to Allah and their husbands. Hafizatun lil ghayb, they protect them behind their backs, in their absence, and the secrets between them and their spouses, no one has any business to it. You don't get on the phone and start telling, you know what he such and such, such and such? No, no, no. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in this particular verse the qualities and characteristics of a sister who's righteous. I don't care how you dress. If you're not following these things, according to Allah, you're not righteous. According to Allah, you're not righteous. If your husband tells you to do something and you got it now, you toe-to-toe with him because, and it's something according to the Quran and Sunnah. And you, well, I don't feel like, and you, who are you? No, 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 no. According to this verse, there's something wrong with your understanding and there's something wrong with your faith. We have issues about the kids. Some of the sisters mentioned about the kids. How can we teach the kids? Well, see, first of all, parents are supposed to be examples, husbands and wives. I'm jumping the gun a little bit on the brothers. But this is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala requires of you as men. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells you what you're supposed to do and what you're not supposed to do. Hitting your wife in the face? No, don't. وَلَا تَحْجُ إِلَّا فِي الْبَيْتِ شَيْخُ ثَيْمِينُ رَحِمَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى makes his concerning this particular narration here. And you don't abandon her except in the home. If you have a difference, nobody outside is supposed to know that there is some tension between you two in the household. You go outside your house, your wife passes, you don't say nothing to her, and people know something's wrong with them. The prophets are like, لَا تَحْجُ إِلَّا فِي الْبَيْتِ you don't do it. That's behind the walls. And your kids are not supposed to be exposed to the nonsense. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he spoke about marriage, right? There are certain regulations that we have in marriage. There are certain regulations we have prior to embarking upon this particular institution. Brothers, you won't know the sister until you marry her. Sisters, you ain't gonna know the brother until you marry him. I'm telling you, it ain't gonna be 100%. And this is why it's important for the fathers to play an important part in checking the brother out. This is why Allah's messenger put them in charge of this institution, the men. And that a sister is not allowed to marry herself without the permission of a guardian. Because the men could see what she can't see in other men. Never be able to see. This is why we have this particular institution. The Prophet ﷺ says, أَيُّمَا بْرَأَةٍ نَكَحَ بِغَيْرِ إِذْنِ وَلِيِّهَا فَنِكَحُهَا بَاطِلٌ فَنِكَحُهَا بَاطِلٌ فَنِكَحُهَا بَاطِلٌ Any lady who performs a marriage, she gets married without the permission of a guardian, and nikah is invalid, it's invalid, it's invalid. Now, the guardian doesn't have the right to force his daughter or his whoever's on his care. The Prophet ﷺ says, لَا تُنْكُلْ بِكُهَتَّى تُسْتَذَنْ A virgin girl should not be given until her permission is sought. If your mom tells you it's okay for you to marry this person and pop says no, it's no. Sisters have no charge in this particular affair. That's a men's domain. When it comes to marrying off, that's the men. They're in charge of that. Okay? And Aisha had the orphans under her care. And it came time to marry, she pointed some of the men. This is their domain, not mine. Okay? So these particular areas... We have to follow the dictates that have been ordained by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the things that we find in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We have an issue where sisters look down on sisters because of their dress code. Now, when I speak about the dress code, if you're wearing some leotards and biker shorts and some spandex, you're supposed to be looked down upon. You should be ashamed of yourself even going out of your house like that. You're not supposed to be dressed up in front of your father like that, much less in front of the whole dunya. So now you're going out, not just in the house, but in the streets like that? So we're not talking about that. That deserves criticism. But some of the issues say that the sisters are covered properly. They don't have their faces and hands covered. And people are looking down on them as if they are damn idiots. Right? That issue, inshallah, I want to go over in some detail. So we know then that the principle in respect to the dress code of the lady is that you're not supposed to be showing yourself. You know, we have this modern type of mentality where you go wearing pants outside. And a shirt in the khimah. Where's that from in Islam? Where's that to be found in the Quran and Sunnah? That a lady goes out like that. What happened to the jilbab that Allah commands you to put over your garment? Or you think that you're Muslim and you do what you want to do and it's all right? Allah tells you, look man, do such and such. Huh, but you know, I don't feel like it. You sound like you're in the church, coming from Sunday school. That type of mentality. You claim to be a Muslim, huh? Allah tells you to do something, you have the evidence from the Quran and the Sunnah, and you want to do what you want to do. The principle then is that the lady, all of us, should be covered, unless you have some text to prove otherwise. Like we have in this discussion, according to some of the Ahlul Ilm. That means nothing on us should be seen. The exception is only the discussion that we have according to some of the Ahlul Ilm. And the closest she is to Allah is when she's in the closed chamber of her home. In the closed chamber of her home. This is what we have in terms of directives, okay? And I mentioned this before, there is a new fad amongst the Muslim women, okay? They wear what they call spandexes. And when they're wearing that, they're wearing these tight jeans, okay? A jean with a shirt or pants with a shirt and a khimar. And sometimes they got their fingernail polished out and lipstick on and other types of makeup. Man, I wonder what Omar would do if he was in our times. How are you going to have a fad like that in the community and everybody keeping quiet? Nobody saying anything from the minbar? Fathers, brothers, husbands? Where's your backbone? Once the sisters, the parents, the mothers start dressing like this, they become an example for the generation to come. The breakdown starts now. And all because we want to use our own feeble intellect as second-guess revelation. Why I gotta do that? What do you mean, why you gotta do it? You Muslim? Yeah, I'm a Muslim. That's why when you hear what you're supposed to do, you buckle. And talk about, well, I don't feel, no, it's kind of difficult, you're being harsh. SubhanAllah, don't you know that's a statement of kufr? You're saying that what you have in the Quran and the Sunnah is harsh? By popular practice that we've seen everybody looking at it like it's good. Sisters going around with their pants, and their shirt, and the khimar, and that's become acceptable. Say to your wives, to your daughters, to the believing women, let them put over themselves the jilabib. This is closer that they may be recognized and not harmed, and Allah is forgiving, merciful. The jilbab, like Ibn Kathir mentioned, this is something that the jilbab was something that the companions, the sahabiyah, used to wear on top of the normal garment that you would have. Okay, for example, in the home, if you're praying, you may have the khimar on, and you may have on a blouse or a skirt, okay, and you may pray like that in the home. But when you went outside, on top of that, there was another garment to give you extra covering. That is the jilbab. The way they used to wear it is from on top of the head all the way down, so that your shape is not shown. Okay? So that is something that was there from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directing us how the ladies are supposed to conduct themselves. Now that doesn't mean that the jilbab can only be black. That's probably a big misunderstanding, because the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Shaykh Nasr pointed out, if you authenticated some of the narrations in the Tabaqat al-Insan, they used to wear other colors than that. Okay? So black is not the only color that you have to wear. And I think that's a popular misunderstanding that we have. And I think I probably went over a little bit.